All right, tonight we begin with this numbers, and that is on the global confirmed cases of coronavirus right here on Ebru TV Primetime News. 137,445, and these are the global confirmed cases of coronavirus. 5,088, these are the total number of people who have succumbed to the virus, and 69,779, and this is the total number of recovered persons from the coronavirus. And of course, looking at this spot over here, Africa is not looking too good. Last week, we were saying that we were a little bit on the clear, but right now, looking at the patches over here, yes, these are the parts of Asia. Europe is not doing too well, but when we look at Africa, we are also not looking too good, but not too bad either as compared to the rest of the nation. So we'll be looking at these numbers a little bit later and understand what they mean, especially for the African continent. But also tonight, the country is in sort of like a panic or shock mode, if you ask me, and that is in relation to the coronavirus, the first case of coronavirus that was confirmed today by the Ministry of Health. What does this mean for Kenya? We understand that some people have entered into panic mode, and people are panic buying almost everything, and more so when it comes to hand sanitizers. Again, what does that mean for the country? Well, you want to stick around till the end of the bulletin. This is Ebru TV Primetime News on this 13th day of March 2020. We have a lot in store for you, but first, the headlines. All right, welcome to the broadcast this evening. My name is Winnie Lubembe. Our sign language interpreter tonight is Joyce Wairimu. Now, the confirmation of the first case of coronavirus reported in Kenya has forced the government to invoke the Public Health Act, which requires restrictions to large public gatherings and events, including church rallies and other school events. Health CS, and that is Mutahi Kagwe, says the restrictions are of no exception to the planned BBI rallies, as well as church conferences. Our reporter Diana Rachel Mbugwa kickstarts our bulletin tonight.
Stay at home. If you feel unwell with symptoms like fever, cough, and difficulties in breathing.
It looks like the meaning of Friday the 13th, which is considered an unlucky day in the Western world, may have proven itself in Kenya today, with the dreaded news of coronavirus reaching the country dawning on Kenyans. Any person who may have planned for a public gathering of any sort may have to reschedule. This is after the first case reported in the country has forced the government to invoke the Public Health Act, with the Health Cabinet Secretary asking Kenyans to be cautious of their surroundings. This will see public meetings like the Building Bridges rally that was scheduled to take place in Nakuru this Saturday cancelled.
The decision was to ban all public rallies. There is no exception.
Churches have also been banned from holding large conferences, but have been allowed to continue with services in their own churches, provided that congregants use sanitizers and adhere to the safety precautions against the pandemic.
We have suspended all public gatherings, meetings, religious crusades, games, and all events that are of a huge public nature.
In addition, the CS has cautioned against inter-school events, meaning schools will not visit each other for major events. Schools will, however, remain open for now. Kenyans have been advised to refrain from shaking hands and regularly wash hands or sanitize with alcohol-based products.
Maintain a distance of at least 1 meter, about 5 feet, between yourself and anyone who is coughing or sneezing. Persons with a cough or sneeze should stay at home or keep a social distance, but avoid mixing with others in a crowd.
An area which may be of much concern is hygiene in the public transport sector, with 90% of Kenyans using public transport daily. Public transport providers have been directed to provide sanitizers to every person boarding either a bus, train or taxi.
The 10th of March, we summoned all the public transport operators, the Matatu associations, the 6 of them, then the SGR management, and also the commuter rail, because collectively like I said, they ferry more than 90% of our people.
Currently, the government has listed 13 countries which have been considered to be at high risk of the coronavirus. Effective today, all level 4 and 5 hospitals have been directed to put up quarantine centers in preparedness of the coronavirus.
The CS has continued to urge Kenyans, especially online, not to disseminate information that may instill fear and panic among Kenyans, even as they continue to put on measures to curb coronavirus, which has had its first case reported here in the country since the outbreak in China. Diana Rachel Mbogwa, Ibru TV. Right, and still on the theme, Kenyans have raised questions after the first case of COVID-19 was confirmed in the country earlier today. This was after a 27-year-old woman was diagnosed with the virus that has been declared a pandemic by the World Health Organization. The patient is said to have arrived in the country on March 5th from the United States through London.
According to the government, the woman fell ill and took herself to the hospital where she tested positive for coronavirus.
That the Ministry of Health has confirmed the first coronavirus case in Kenya.
According to Kenyans on and offline, it is not clear where this woman has been from March 5th to March 13th when she was quarantined at Mbagathi Hospital. In these 8 days, she might have boarded a plane and taken a taxi from JKIA to her location. She might have visited the store to buy items and interacted with several people. These are some of the presumptions made by Kenyans.
The case was confirmed on the 12th, which was last night, as the first one to be reported in Kenya since the beginning of the outbreak in China.
The Ministry of Health has sent a rapid response team to Ongata Rungai, where the lady with coronavirus hails from.
We have embarked on a contact tracing for all persons who have been in contact with the lady who is now in Kenyatta.
The Kenyan government has started tracking passengers on board the flight which the 27-year-old used to travel, sentiments that have baffled many on how the government will carry out the task.
But I also want to add, ladies and gentlemen, that at this juncture, what we have is a coronavirus positive test. No more than that. Therefore, Kenyans will live normally. Wherever you are going, go normally. Do carry out your business normally. Go to the shopping center normally. And there is no cause for alarm. So I wish also to add that going forward, there will be some inconveniences that citizens are going to experience. We apologize in advance. But this is one time when we are calling for serious citizen responsibility.
The government has urged Kenyans to be keen and calm, even as it urges Kenyans to take all precautions against the disease. The World Health Organization has confirmed more than 80,419 cases globally, with more than 3,000 deaths.
Every citizen must play their part so that we manage this tragedy and serious problem we have in the nation.
To date, there is no vaccine and no specific antiviral medicine to prevent or treat coronavirus. Abdiaziz Hashim, Ibru TV.
Right, thanks very much, Abdi. Now, earlier on, the health CS, and that is Mutahi Kagwe, of course, during the press briefing, announced that he has invoked the Public Health Act. And of course, let's just take a look at some of the clauses of the Public Health Act and, of course, what they entail. And we begin with the general duties of the health authorities, and they take all lawful, necessary, and under its special circumstances, reasonably practicable or practicable rather, measures communicable or preventable diseases to safeguard and promote the public health and to exercise the powers and perform the duties in respect. They also, in provision of conveyance for infected persons, any health authority may provide and maintain a carriage or carriages suitable for the conveyance of the person suffering from any infectious disease. Now, 26 says removal to hospital of infected persons, isolation of persons who have been exposed to infection, and penalty for exposure of infected persons and things. Any person who willfully exposes himself without proper precautions against spreading and, you know, the said disease in any street, being in charge of any person so suffering, so exposes such sufferer, and of course gives, lends, sells, transmits or exposes without previous disinfection anything exposed to infection from any such disease. Now, penalty for failing to provide for disinfection of public conveyance, well, rules for prevention of disease, the speedy intermittent of the dead, house-to-house visitation, provision of medical aid and accommodation, preventing any person from leaving any infected area, and of course the formation of hospitals and observation camps or stations, of course the removal of persons who are suffering from an infectious disease and persons who have been in contact with such persons. Now, the regulation of hospitals used for the reception of persons suffering from an infectious disease and of observation camps and stations, of course, entails the removal and disinfection of articles which have been exposed to infection. So these are some of, the Public Health Act that, of course, the CS was forced to invoke earlier on during a press briefing, and of course, while just giving an update on the first case of coronavirus in the country. Now, still in the summer, the country is still reeling from that announcement, and that is that the coronavirus has hit home, which has clearly confirmed Kenyans' worst fears. The announcement is also putting the spotlight on the government over its level of preparedness, with many feeling it is not yet ready. Our reporter Kenneth Kazungu spoke to a few Kenyans, and here is what they had to say.
The Ministry of Health has confirmed the first coronavirus case in Kenya.
It is an announcement that confirmed the worst fears of many, with Kenyans feeling that the monster has finally caught up with us even before the government was ready.
Kusikia that corona imefika Kenya, first of all, imeni scare. Because as we know, our country, we are never ready for anything. Locust peke yake imetushinda ku handle. People are suffering because of that. So corona, misioni ni kama the government itaweza kudeal nayo.
Nimestuka sana. Maana watu wetu hapa wako na mchezo sana. Hawasukuli kama ni kitu inaweza lete madhara. Na vile tunasikia ije watu imeua watu wengi.
Nasikia the current person, the first person mwenye amepatikana nayo, anakaa ni super spreader kwa sababu alitoka JKI akakuja akaishi Ongatarongai akaenda aka travel mpaka Eldoret akirudi. So between that travel and movements anaweza kuwa amewashikisha watu wengi sana.
The moment after the announcement marked the beginning of the wave of fear among Kenyans, with many still feeling that they are yet to learn about the virus.
Lakini mimi kusikia maneno ya coronavirus ni kuiona naona kwa TV venye naonyeshwa vidonda, but sijui venye inaka.
I will think it's a common cold. What do I do? Nitaenda nichukue antihistamines na hiyo symptoms itapotea. So before it comes out nitakuwa nime spread to many people because I will be asymptomatic.
Symptoms zake ni hiyo homa. Saa zingine hata unaweza kuwa una harahara na hizo mahomahoma.
Health CS Mutahi Kagwe says you should stay at home if you interact with persons with coronavirus-like symptoms.
Assume I'm working kwa mjengo. Every week I must get something to feed my children, to pay rent and such things. So it's not practical.
Where I'm coming from, I've met people. Where I'm going to, I've met people. Because for me to do my job, I have to meet people. So nikisema I won't meet people, then I won't earn.
Sisi ni watu wa jua kali. Ni watu tunatafuta chakula hiji, hatuna ati akiba tuko tumejiwekea. Inaweza kuwa na madhara makubwa sana hapa kwetu.
With others saying more action need to be taken, especially in schools.
From PP1 up to around class 3, wenye hawajui kujichunga, so our for now, government need to stop schooling for those children.
Naogopa, naofia. Juu hata venye nimekaa hapa hivi, sijui ni nani mwingine tunakuja kaa na yeye. Na huenda naweza kuwa hata already niko nayo.
The wave of fear has also gripped public service vehicle operators and users, who feel that they are severely exposed.
Naofia lakini juu ni jobu, sasa nitafanya nini?
Naofia cause hata uwezi jua nani yako nayo na uwezi jua nani ana.
Tangu February tumeanza kusikia ugonjwa si mzuri, ni ugonjwa mbaya sana, inaua.
And what about this directive by the government?
Public transport providers are directed to provide hand sanitizers for their clients.
Sasa hizo hand sanitizer ni walete, wakileta tutawapea. Sasa sisi
nyinyi watu wa matatu mnafahamu bike.
Mwenye gari akinunua ni sawa. Lakini sio mimi nitoe pesa yangu kwa mfuko ninunue.
It is clear that the government has a bigger task, not only in preventing the spread of coronavirus, but also raise its awareness.
All right, and of course, mixed reactions over there. Some people are scared. Others are like, you know what? We'll survive this. We will overcome this. Well, we are about to take a very short break, but when we come back, we have Dr. Moses Masika, who is a virologist, of course, here, you know, with us to just analyze. Now that corona, the first case of coronavirus has been reported in the country, what does that mean to the Kenyans and, of course, Africans at large? What are we supposed to do to prevent the spread of the same? Since it has been reported in the country, you'd not want to miss that interview. We'll see you after this very short break. Stay with us. All right, welcome back. Glad you're still with us. This is Ebru TV Primetime News, and our focus today is mostly on coronavirus and the fact that we have one case already reported in the country. What does that mean for us as a country, as a government, as a nation in general? Because people are scared. So from the video earlier on, where our reporter Kenneth Kazungu spoke to some of the people, some are saying, you know what, I am very, very scared. Of course, just to analyze that and to help us understand more on what does this mean for us as a Kenyans or as Kenyans and what we need to do to ensure that we do not spread the virus. Of course, we have Dr. Moses Masika, who is a virologist from the University of Nairobi. Again, thank you very much for coming back.
Thank you for having me.
Really, really appreciate your time. From the Health CS's presser earlier on this morning, there's something that he said that really caught my attention, which I think we can start with. And he said that we only have the COVID-19 positive test, no more than that. What does that mean? Because for us, as long as it's coronavirus, everybody is already in panic mode.
I think that was a good emphasis, because the fact that we have a case of COVID-19 in the country doesn't mean that we are all dead, as some people want to imply. And I think the point that we should get from that is that this is not the time to panic.
Okay.
It's a time to do what we can, and that's quite a bit, to curb the spread of this virus, rather than panicking. Because when you panic, then you can't, you feel helpless, and you can't do, you'd make decisions that can actually put you at risk, rather than help you to control the situation.
All right.
So I think that's the main point there.
Okay.
Yes.
But don't you think, sort of like panic, and I'm using the word panic very carefully,
yes,
sort of helps in one way or the other? The sense that, I mean, if you are sort of scared, then you might do all it takes to ensure that, one, you do not contract the infection, and two, you do not spread it to the person next to you.
It's right to be concerned. Everyone now should be concerned and have the push to do the right thing. Because without, if we take things as if nothing has changed, of course we will be doing the wrong thing. But that doesn't mean we go to the extreme of panicking. We should be concerned. And that concern should push us to wash our hands more often, avoid crowds, and do all that it takes to prevent this infection from spreading, either from us or to us.
Okay.
Yes.
And we'll talk about the aspect of hand washing in a little bit. I mean, earlier on, even before the virus was discovered, it is important for all of us to wash our hands regularly. But back then it wasn't as serious as now, where everybody is now washing their hands, using sanitizers, using soap and water and all those things. We'll talk about then the technique, how. Because you see, most of us think it's just as long as you have soap on your hands, you're good to go. But there's a specific technique. And we saw, WHO Director General, of course, earlier on, demonstrating how we should do it and passing on a challenge, people to share their videos of washing their hands. We'll talk about that a little bit later. There's some words that we have been using. We have epidemic, endemic, and pandemic.
Yes.
Do they mean the same thing or are they different?
Well, an endemic disease is one that is occurring throughout. Mm-hmm. It's occurring usually at low numbers, like malaria. We can say malaria is endemic in mm-hmm. Kisumu, for example, because okay. you have cases throughout the year mm-hmm. and it's there for a long time. Mm-hmm. An epidemic is one that occurs as an outbreak mm-hmm. in either within a country or a few countries, and it's limited mm-hmm. if you compare it to a pandemic. Mm-hmm. A pandemic is what we have now, yeah. where you have an infection that spreads across many countries mm-hmm. with numerous cases. Okay. But epidemic and pandemic should be short-lived, mm-hmm. or, although sometimes they can last long, mm-hmm. most of the time they're able to have a limited duration.
Yeah.
But an endemic disease mm-hmm. could also be cleared, but generally it takes, mm-hmm. it's been there for a long period. So endemic diseases are those that we have learned mm-hmm. to live with, so to speak.
Yeah.
An epidemic comes, it may come and go, mm-hmm. come back again.
Right.
But a pandemic has a global reach and affects many more countries and many more people.
All right.
But really, I should insist that for me, whatever we call coronavirus or COVID-19 is not so important as to what we do about it. Mm-hmm. So whatever you want to call the disease,
exactly.
whether you want to call it a pandemic or an endemic, it really doesn't make mm-hmm. a big difference.
Mm-hmm.
And what makes a difference mm-hmm. is the actions you take to
what
respond
you do
to it.
About it. And we'll talk about then what should we do now that we have the virus in the country. But now, in terms of how serious is this virus, because you know earlier on when it was reported, so many people lost their lives, and especially in Wuhan. But then again, right now the numbers are sort of plateaued in China as compared to the other parts of the of the globe.
Yes.
But then again, so how serious is this? Because when it started,
serious.
It was like, coronavirus equals death. But right now, that is not. We're trying as much as possible to make that not be the case.
For many people, it's still equals to death. In fact, just as I was walking in,
mm-hmm.
I met some guys chatting and they were saying we are finished.
Yeah.
Which shows that for a lot of people, mm-hmm. coronavirus or COVID-19 means death, which it shouldn't.
Mm-hmm.
And as you said rightly, we've seen the epidemic or the outbreak dying off now in China.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, it can still surge back and cause more cases.
Mm-hmm.
But that gives you hope that it can be controlled if you take the right measures.
Mm-hmm.
In most of these places, we've seen that it's not lethal in most of the cases.
Mm-hmm.
That for most people, they will get mm-hmm. an infection that their bodies can deal with.
Okay.
And this is as many as over 80 in 100 people mm-hmm. are able to recover even with minimal hospital intervention. For
mm-hmm.
those that need care,
mm-hmm.
if they receive the right care, like we've seen in many countries, many of them will recover.
Mm-hmm.
But it's true that we'll lose a few. Usually 3 or 4 people in every 100,
mm-hmm.
in some places less.
Mm-hmm.
And for some age groups,
mm-hmm.
Especially the elderly, much more more likely or at risk to die. Mm-hmm. So coronavirus is not equal to death.
Yeah.
It is, in fact, most of the people recover within 2 weeks
mm-hmm.
and they're able to live their lives.
Okay.
The only thing that might end up getting hit and take a while to recover is the economy, as we say. Because when people get scared, they do things that jeopardize
the economy.
And that's why we need to ensure that scare it doesn't cause us to harm ourselves
mm-hmm.
in trying to help ourselves.
Yeah. All right then. But now let's come back to the country and that aspect of, again, from what the CS said earlier on, is that this lady, of course, traveled through so many airports until she got into the country.
Yes.
And from all those airports, of course, she was screened and she was okay until she got into the country. And I think that is where then the thing is. And so many people actually ask the question because, again, through all those airports, came into the country, of course, did not just sit in one place. She moved here and there. Interacted with so many people, and then until she took herself to the hospital, and then that is when, of course, tests were done. It was declared that she tested positive. So then, during her interaction with so many people, that is where people are scared. What if she might have infected so many other people, including her family?
Yes, that's a genuine question,
mm-hmm.
and it shouldn't surprise us that she came in undetected, because you could be in the incubation period,
mm-hmm.
where after infection. You are not showing any symptoms.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
We do not know how long she showed symptoms for before. That was information wasn't given to us.
Yeah.
Maybe it was 2 days before she went to hospital. Maybe it was a day. Maybe it wasn't. We don't know.
Mm-hmm.
And what we know is that during the period that people are showing symptoms,
mm-hmm.
when somebody is coughing and sneezing, that's when they are most likely to infect others.
Mm-hmm.
So for the period that they may have been walking around without symptoms, if The chances of infecting others are much lower than when she's showing symptoms. Mm-hmm. And it's true that she may have, the people who were sitting close to her, working with her, mm-hmm. staying in the same house with her, mm-hmm. and other contacts are at risk. Mm-hmm. They have been exposed. Mm-hmm. And I think the government has taken the measures, at least from the reports we've heard, we've had, mm-hmm. to trace these people, yeah. and assess the risk and assess if they are getting sick. Mm-hmm. That's the best you can do, okay. because you have to observe them for at least another 2 weeks to know if they were infected.
Okay.
Yes.
So at what point is then the infection sort of like dangerous that it can infect another person? Because like you're saying,
yes.
She might be in the incubation period not showing any signs and symptoms,
yes.
and all those things. So when is, yes. one likely to sort of infect the other people, or when is the virus
most infectious? Usually when they're showing symptoms, and that's because, mm-hmm. this in the virus is transmitted through droplets, yeah. and every time you sneeze or you cough, mm-hmm. you expel the virus through, mm-hmm. the droplets, and then the persons around you can be exposed. Okay. It's possible, of course, we've seen in a few cases that people who are asymptomatic, mm-hmm. may also infect others, mm-hmm. but the risk is much bigger, mm-hmm. when somebody is showing symptoms for the reasons of cough, sneezing, and all that, that is a means of the virus, yes. to leave you and, mm-hmm. Enter someone else through either touch or even contamination, mm-hmm. or they land into their face or their nose. Mm-hmm. So most at risk time is when they are showing symptoms, because they are coughing and sneezing.
Okay.
But it's also possible to transmit when they are not.
When they're not,
yes.
Yeah.
But that's much lower risk. What we've seen driving the current outbreak, mm-hmm. is people actually showing
symptoms. Yes. Yeah. So then when you're showing the symptoms, what are you supposed to do? Are you supposed to self-isolate?
So at this point,
take yourself to the hospital?
At this point at the country, where we are in the country, mm-hmm. we need to diagnose all the new cases so that we can trace, mm-hmm. the contacts. Yeah. So it means if you suspect you've been exposed, mm-hmm. and exposure means you've come into contact with somebody who is sick, mm-hmm. or somebody was taking care, mm-hmm. of the sick, mm-hmm. or somebody, even if they're not confirmed to have COVID-19 or showing such symptoms,
okay.
then you need to contact the hotline, mm-hmm. and you'll be advised where you can go for testing.
All right.
And this is in order to keep track of who is positive, mm-hmm. and that will help us in controlling the infection. Yes, but in the process of getting help, you should isolate yourself from others so that you don't interact too much with them. Mm-hmm. If you can get a mask and you're sick, you wear the mask to protect others around you,
mm-hmm.
and call the hospital in advance so that they prepare for you.
Okay.
Yes, but for these people, they are most likely to be isolated, mm-hmm. at a common, either a hospital ward, mm-hmm. where they can be monitored and their contacts, mm-hmm. traced. Yes.
So, how fast do you think then, and especially in relation to still the lady,
yes.
how fast do you think the government will be able to trace all those people?
Yes. You'd be surprised how easy it is.
We're talking from the airplane,
yes.
To all the areas that she has been through,
yes.
to even the person probably, if she used a taxi, to the person who probably was moving her around and all those things. How fast do you think this will happen? Because now people are like, wait, what if probably I came into contact with her and not knowing?
Yes.
Because at this time she wasn't showing any signs and symptoms.
So there are those casual contacts who may not be easy to find because people don't even know her.
Yeah.
But for those that we know who are living, mm-hmm. in the same house, mm-hmm. working in the same space, mm-hmm. sitting next to them in public transport, especially, mm-hmm. in the airplane, mm-hmm. these ones are easy to find. Mm-hmm. Of course, some may escape the dragnet, especially if somebody met casually, a handshake and passed on, mm-hmm. And moved on to their business. It may be a bit harder to trace those ones,
mm-hmm.
but for those that we know, mm-hmm. for those that we know they share spaces, mm-hmm. and other social circles,
mm-hmm.
it's very easy to track them because their phone numbers, these days everyone has a phone, mm-hmm. and it's, mm-hmm. easy to call up, and even for those who now are close to her and know that she's sick, many of them will just present themselves,
mm-hmm.
to the facility for, mm-hmm. assessment because you don't want to wait until you're sick. Yes.
All right. Yes. So then our time is far much spent, and like we said earlier on, now go to pharmacies, supermarkets, or anywhere else that you can get the mask, they're not there anymore. And if they're there, they're slightly expensive.
Yes.
So then what do we do? Fine. The case has been confirmed into the country. People are scared. What if I might be exposed to this person? What are we supposed to do at this point? And this is to all the Kenyans.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Now, generally, as we said, mm-hmm. we now need to take care so much more because we have a case in the country, meaning it could easily spread to others. It's not just something out there. That means social distancing for both those who are infected and those who are not. Of course, we can't stop talking about cleaning hands and surfaces and cleaning them properly, as you said. We also need to talk about avoiding public places that or gatherings that are not necessary. And for people who are sick, to actually present early, not to wait until everything is gone out of control. And you can actually call before you, even instead of going to a hospital, you can call and get that information cleared so that you are advised appropriately. So I think there's a lot as a Kenyan you can do to prevent or protect yourself and protect others.
All right.
Yes.
But what about the masks?
The masks are not
supposed to wear
the masks are not for everyone. Okay. Right now, we advise people who are taking care of the sick, especially healthcare workers, to use them. And if you have a relative who is sick and you're the one taking them to hospital, it would be help to have a mask at that point. But the two most important people who need to wear these masks are those that are sick to avoid infecting others, and those that are taking care of the sick. For the general public, it's not much of a help or effective too, because you'll shake hands, you'll touch something, you don't wash your hands, the mask won't
help. I see some people who are just buying one mask and, you know, intending to wear that one mask for as long as when trouble.
No, that's you're wearing a contaminated mask, which then can cause you more problems. And it shows some of the challenges we have with the people wearing masks, because they don't know how to use them most of the time. And when taking it off, if you don't clean your hands, then you're likely to contaminate your face again. And also many times when you have something on your face, you keep touching it to try and adjust it, because it's something strange and you're not used to it. So in the process, you end up increasing the risk rather than reducing it. So I would say don't rush to get a mask, really. You can get a hand sanitizer if you can afford it, or just water and soap. But the masks are for those who are sick or those who are taking care of the sick.
Of the sick. All right, then. And as we're finished, then, the aspect of then hand sanitizers. What type? Or
the best.
What is the content here?
The best are alcohol-based. And the best percentages are about 80% alcohol. Yes, so if you can get an alcohol-based hand rub, around 80% alcohol, that would be nice.
Some people are saying, see, we can just wash our hands with alcohol.
That would be
that
too expensive.
That has 80%.
Yes. It would be too expensive. Hand sanitizers are much cheaper than most alcohol brands. I know maybe you know some brands that are not as expensive.
You know, but the alcohol content is not up, up to what we're expecting. All right, then, as we finish, there was a Chinese advisor who was saying coronavirus pandemic could be over by June. And it is, this is if countries act. Do you think this is possible?
It is possible. And I say this because there are mathematical models that you can use to see how infections are spreading. We saw a drop in cases yesterday compared to the day before, the number of new cases reported, although more countries in Africa, four countries today are reporting, which means if we can sustain this drop, we may see what we saw in China in early February, when they had a sustained drop of cases to date they haven't gained. So it is possible, but it's also possible that even with models, you can be wrong and the outbreak lasts much longer. So we should be prepared for really both scenarios, so that we hope for the best, but be ready in case it lasts much longer.
All right, Dr. Moses, thank you very much again. This is a conversation that we can have over and over and over again. So please come back.
If you invite me.
Yeah, we will. Definitely we will invite you.
Yes.
You know, just to come in and help us understand more on COVID-19. And that has been Dr. Moses Masika, who is a virologist at the University of Nairobi. Like what he said, do not panic, take necessary measures to protect yourself and your loved ones. But still on the same case of coronavirus, the county government of Nakuru has established a bed capacity isolation ward at the Nakuru Level 5 hospital amid national efforts to contain the spread of the dreaded coronavirus. Again, so many hospitals, of course, taking initiative for the same. But Ethiopia, Gabon and Ghana have confirmed their first cases of coronavirus, bringing the number of countries with coronavirus cases in sub-Saharan Africa to 16. And in a statement, Gabon's government said its case was a 27-year-old Gabonese who had returned home from France on March 8th. And elsewhere, Ethiopia, Gabon and Ghana have confirmed their first cases of coronavirus, bringing the number of countries with coronavirus cases in Africa to 16. Now, in a statement, Gabon's government said its case was a 27-year-old Gabonese man who had returned from France on March 8th.
Sub-Saharan Africa has so far been less badly hit by COVID-19 compared to Europe, China or the United States. According to the World Health Organization, only 16 countries have reported positive for the deadly virus that has been termed a global pandemic.
WHO has been assessing this outbreak around the clock, and we're deeply concerned both by the alarming levels of spread and severity and by the alarming levels of inaction. We have therefore made the assessment that COVID-19 can be characterized as a pandemic. Pandemic is not a word to use lightly or carelessly. It's a word that, if misused, can cause unreasonable fear or unjustified acceptance that the fight is over, leading to unnecessary suffering and death.
Most of the reported cases have allegedly been in foreigners or people who had traveled abroad. In a tweet earlier Friday, Takele Umabanti, Ethiopia's mayor of the capital Addis Ababa, tweeted that a Japanese citizen was the person affected by the virus. The country's health minister, Lia Tadise, however, said there were no plans to cancel any flights. In Ghana, the health ministry said its two cases were people who had returned recently from Norway and Turkey. Sub-Saharan Africa did not confirm its first coronavirus until February 28th in Nigeria. Egypt continues to carry the highest burden of the virus with 67 confirmed cases, followed by Algeria with 25 confirmed cases. South Africa has recorded 17 cases, Senegal 10, Tunisia 7, Morocco 6, Nigeria, Cameroon and Burkina Faso have 2 confirmed cases each, while Togo, the DRC, Cote d'Ivoire, Ethiopia, Ghana, Gabon and now Kenya have 1 each. However, concerns are growing among the continent's ability to handle the potential rapid spread of a virus that has infected over 130 people and killed over 4,900 people worldwide, given the already fragile health systems. Winnie Lubembe for Ebru TV.
All right, time for us to take another very short break. But when we come back, we'll be taking a look at how the COVID-19, and that is coronavirus, has affected business. Stay with us. Welcome back. Now, Insurance Regulatory Authority has changed tune and assured Kenyans that they will be covered in case they get infected by the coronavirus. The authority says their decision was informed by the government's mitigation measures aimed at minimizing exposure.
With the World Health Organization declaring coronavirus a global pandemic, infected persons will not get treatment under their medical cover, some health insurers in the country has warned. The Insurance Regulatory Authority has said any policyholder who gets infected with the virus will be covered, making a U-turn on the initial stand. A day earlier, the IRA Commissioner of Insurance had said policyholders will not be covered. The IRA further stated that they are engaging with the National Emergency Response Committee on coronavirus as a part of its mandate to advise the government on insurance matters. IRA further stated that epidemics and pandemics are excluded in the policy documents, calling on those with insurance covers to peruse through the terms. Standard medical insurance typically excludes epidemics and pandemics, meaning victims of the disease will not be able to recoup coronavirus-related expenses. The Association of Kenya Insurers, AKI, say the classification of the disease as the pandemic indicates that victims will settle their own bills if cases are reported in Kenya. But Insurance Regulatory Authority has said insurance company will offer insurance to the people who will be affected by the virus. According to Chief Executive Association of Kenya Insurance, Tom Gichuhi, he said, and I quote, "If there was to be a major attack, then all insurance companies will close shop. The claims will wipe the insurers out completely. This is why such exclusions are put in the insurance policies." End of quote. The virus has curtailed movement of people, with scores of businesses shutting down plants and stores, hurting global trade. Kenya's Ministry of Health banned all international conferences and meetings last week. Reporting for Ebru TV, I'm Kaindo Stefano.
And elsewhere, coronavirus is likely to take a toll on Kenya's projected gross domestic growth, currently estimated at 6%. This is according to National Treasury CS Ukuri Yatani, who noted that the ministry had formed a multi-agency team to evaluate the impact of the coronavirus on the country's economy, with plans to roll out a cautionary facility. As Busara Naman reports, investors at the Nairobi Securities Exchange lost 119.6 billion shillings in value as the domestic markets tumbled on the back of Kenya's first confirmed case of the coronavirus.
As Kenya confirms its first coronavirus case, there are fears that the virus will see the shilling shed its value against major currencies, an effect that will push up import cost and eventually the cost of living. On Wednesday, the World Health Organization declared the coronavirus outbreak a global pandemic. The general global economic activities have been constrained in one way or another, while imports are shrinking and the production cost is surging. And now the country is likely to see a drop in GDP and increased inflation. However, Yatani hinted at a possible fiscal budget review to focus funds on primary sectors of the economy. Also, Yatani revealed that the country has already applied for 5 billion shillings from the IMF to support the Ministry of Health in its planning for coronavirus. Further, Competition Authority of Kenya has warned traders against hiking of prices. In a statement, the competition watchdog says defaulters will attract a penalty of up to 10% of their respective turnover as provided in the Competition Act. CAK's Director General Wang'ombe Kariuki has urged Kenyans to report any case of hiked pricing to the authorities' offices. Sentiments also supported by Health CS Mutahi Kagwe.
An appeal to the business community, because I say this is immoral, really, for this, in this situation, for people to increase their prices not because of the cost of production but to make abnormal profits. And we can only appeal. At the moment, we have not engaged into price controls, we have not started that process. Obviously, if it went haywire, then the government would discuss and see what measures to take. But at the moment, we are just appealing to the business community to exercise some reasonable behavior in terms of pricing of goods and services as well.
Elsewhere, at exactly 2:38 p.m. on Friday, the Nairobi Security Exchange halted its activity as provided in the NSE equity trading rules. As per the provisions of Rule 941, Section 2 of the NSE Equity Trading Rules, should the NSE 20 share index decrease by more than 5% at the opening session compared to its closing value, or during the continuous session compared to its opening value, the exchange may temporarily halt trading for not more than 30 minutes. Investors at the Nairobi Security Exchange lost 119.6 billion in value as the domestic markets tumbled on the back of Kenya's first confirmed case of the coronavirus. The massive dislocation in stocks saw the NSE step in to halt further bloodshed by halting trade 12 minutes to the close of the day's trading as the NSE 20 index tumbled by 5%, forcing the NSE equity trading rules to kick in. The rules, which prompt the halting of trade for not more than 30 minutes, were a saving grace to the exchange as the NSE market capitalization threatened to fall below the 2 trillion mark. Busara Naman for Ebru TV.
And away from matters corona, ex-Nairobi Deputy Governor Polycarp Igathe has resigned as the Executive Vice President, Sales and Marketing at Vivo Energy. He was previously the Nairobi Deputy Governor, a position he resigned from citing ideological differences with his boss, Governor Mike Sonko. Now, before his short stint in politics, Igathe had been working at Vivo Energy as the Chief Executive Officer. Igathe rejoined Vivo Energy in August 2019. As the Executive Vice President in charge of sales across the oil marketing company's operations in Africa. This was after he left his job as the Managing Director at Equity Bank less than a year after appointment in 2018, where he was reporting to the group's chief executive, James Mwangi. Igathe was in the headlines a few weeks ago after the IEBC said he did not duly resign as the deputy governor of Nairobi. The reason for his exit has, however, not been established, and it remains unclear where he may be headed to. All right, we'll be having a comprehensive story on Igathe's resignation at Vivo Energy tomorrow. But for now, time for us to take another very short breather. But when we come back, we'll be telling you how COVID-19 has affected the sporting world. Stay with us. Welcome back. Now, growing fears related to the global spread of coronavirus have begun to manifest into official decisions to postpone, alter, or cancel events around the globe. With the novel virus not going away anytime soon, sports leagues and organizers of sporting events in the country have been forced to be postponed in the country. Our very own Davis Mberia has more on the effect of coronavirus in the sporting world in the country.
The escalating coronavirus outbreak has brought more disruption in sports, not only internationally but also locally, with the games cancelled or played without spectators and news of possible quarantine for some athletes.
Thank you very much, Davis Mberia, for that. Now, a battle royale amongst drivers is in the offing in the KCB Kasarani Autocross 3 that is penciled for Moi International Sports Centre racetrack on March 22nd. Kasarani Autocross has every reason to attract enthusiasts for the simple reason that entry is absolutely free of charge to spectators. Two-wheel drive, non-turbo buggy leader Zamir Varji has promised to replicate his purple patch after setting the fastest time of the day on both rounds held thus far. Although tipped to vanquish his opponents with relative ease, Varji faces a test of nerves and skills as he will be up against Rajveer Thethi and Zubir Manji. All right, and that marks the end of our bulletin tonight on the Friday, the 13th, 2020. My name is Winnie Lubembe. On behalf of an amazing team who put together this bulletin, from our reporters to our technical team behind, who you never get to see, not forgetting our camera persons, we wish you a lovely night ahead. And of course, not forgetting our sign anchor tonight has been Joyce Warimu. Have yourselves a lovely night. God bless. Stay safe. And remember, do not panic. Observe the basic hygiene, and that is hand washing. As well as, of course, if you cannot get soap and water, then use a hand sanitizer. And as well as, be sure to keep an eye if you notice a person has some of the symptoms, and of course stay away from them. But if you have the symptoms, remember to self-isolate. Good night, God bless, enjoy your weekend.